One of the most talked about platforms throughout today and globally is a Silicon Valley startup that has now quite a strong Asian presence and Asian usage. We're using it today. We saw it on the screen just a second ago. It is, of course, Twitter. And we're very pleased today to have James Kondo, who is the VP of Market Development of Asia for Twitter, joining us for a quick conversation. James, please come on out. Okay, we've just heard about ROI. Can we just shift a little bit into ROI and Twitter? Do you measure ROI? How would you measure ROI?
Yeah, we.
What's the value of a tweet?
Yeah, I think there are three levels. I love the session before because it's what we get asked all the time. You know, does Twitter pay? I think the first level is very numerical and what ad people tend to focus on, and that's really engagement rate. And the engagement rate we're seeing, for example, on promoted tweets, is about 1 to 3% in general, and it's a little bit higher for mobile, which is a magnitude of order higher than typically like 0.06% that you tend to see on click-through rate for your display ads. So I think the 1 to 3% is what we're seeing. More creative people get higher numbers. I think that's the first level, which is really sort of pure.
So you're talking about an engagement measurement here.
Yeah. So it could be a retweet, it could be a reply, it could be favorite. People are engaging with that tweet. But I think what's maybe more important, which is about the topic that was discussed before, is what does that do for your business? And we're building a whole range of cases around what creative companies are doing to drive revenue and drive down cost. And I think for Twitter, there are two things in particular that I think have worked really well. One of them is linking to product launches. And I think one of the things we can say about Twitter, particularly around trends, is that it's one of the few platforms where you can really create a large social movement. And so any movie launches, any car launches, any sort of games that you're organizing, Twitter can dominate the conversation. And we have about 400 million tweets per day happening on our platform. You can be that event. You can be that launch. And Olympics was a tremendous example of how brands engaged and really dominated the conversation on the planet. And the share of the 400 million tweets around the Olympics was amazing. But I think a lot of product launches are happening in that way. The third level, which I'd love to mention, is really not business per se. But I think I just want to point out how Twitter was used during the earthquake in Japan last year, or how Twitter was used in the Middle East around major social movements. And I think we're very, very proud that Twitter is a platform not only about just knowing about what's going on, it's how people take action. And these are like tens of millions of people who get organized. And so okay. I think you can take it at very different levels from like an ad metric to like a business metric. But fundamentally, you want people to be super excited and talking about and engaging and doing something around what you're doing. So I think we're looking at it at three levels and talking to companies about how we track those cases.
Okay, let's zoom back a little bit.
Okay.
Twitter in Asia, how important is it to Twitter? How important is Asia to Twitter? Are you a Silicon Valley invader?
Well, Asia is very important. Japan was the first international office that Twitter opened. It's probably one of the most active Twitter-using countries in the world. It's obviously very mobile-heavy, not just Japan, Asia in general. What we're seeing in Korea right now with a fast mobile and smartphone penetration means that our whole platform needs to move to basically mobile and smartphones. And I think Twitter, in that respect, Asia is going to be the frontier of what's going to happen on Twitter, because we need to be basically a smartphone-ready company as we are, but really looking at it from maybe about 2 or 3 years ahead of Europe and the US in that sense. And we believe that the way that Twitter is organized around just 140 words and keeping it super simple.
140 characters in English, 140 words.
Sorry, 140 characters.
In a character-based language.
Yeah, sorry.
Which is an interesting point in Asia,
right.
How, you know, we did a measurement once looking at the length of a tweet in English, how much you can fit into that versus, in Japanese
pretty much,
or Chinese.
You can pretty much get 3 to 5 times more information in 140 characters, in Asia versus
English. And in fact, in many Asian countries, it is a blogging platform and not a...
Yeah, people are writing almost a paragraph, and 3 people are replying to each other in 140 characters in Asia, which makes us a little bit broader platform in Asia. But I think I just want to point out that, you know, to your question, is Asia important? Super important. It's where the smartphone penetration is. It's where our biggest growth is in terms of active users. And I think, frankly, a lot of the innovative users of Twitter are happening in this region. And so, you know, my role, in addition to like opening Japan for, is to really open a whole range of presence across Asia and to reach out to, you know, marketers, creative marketers in the region who are already doing incredible things. But to support you from a platform perspective.
Okay, Twitter is doing interesting things in Asia. Give us an example.
Yeah, I think this is something I discussed yesterday, but the most innovative thing that I feel personally passionate about is the role that Twitter played in the earthquake.
Maybe to tell your story.
Yeah, so, on 3/11, Japan, Tohoku earthquake, Twitter was, the mobile phone was down, the mobile email system was down. Twitter was one of the only things that was running.
Well, apparently, when the earthquake began, you were on the phone negotiating a contract.
I was on the phone negotiating with, on a real-time search deal. I couldn't, I was so frustrated because the phone went dead. But what that meant was that I couldn't connect with my family, I couldn't connect with my colleagues as to whether people were alive at that time. And Twitter was one of the only things that was running. People managed to connect on Twitter to tell their friends that they were alive, but at the same time, get real-time information about the earthquake, the tsunami, the nuclear disaster, and then also get information about where they should evacuate to. And people who are stranded would tweet out, and helicopters would come in and save them. Tens of millions of people were using the platform to really like save lives or get saved, and people were solving issues simultaneously as things were unfolding. And for about 7 hours, Twitter was the only thing that people could use. And so, when I think about exciting...
Well, maybe give you gave some examples yesterday.
Yeah, so there's this woman, a mother, who was stranded on the third floor. A tsunami was hitting that building. And her son, who was the only person who could come and save her, was in the UK. So she tweeted out to her son saying, I'm stranded, the tsunami's coming, can you do something to save me? But he was in London. So he picked up this tweet, and then he tweeted to the vice governor of Tokyo, who immediately sent a helicopter to that building because her tweet was geotagged, and she was saved, the group was saved. And there are hundreds of stories like that of a call for help being disseminated throughout Twitter, and people sending help, people sending evacuation, very, very inspirational things that happen, which frankly, to be honest, Twitter was a platform, but users innovated in terms of calling out for help, getting help, and it was a real privilege. And I want to point that out because that's the sort of stuff that really excites us about the promise and the potential for Twitter, because when you can change a society or when you can really mobilize the whole public, we think we are one of the very, very few platforms that have had the privilege of doing that, not only in Japan, in the Middle East, all around the world, and it shows the kind of potential and the power that people who are very, very creative can deploy on our platform.
You spoke about some of the uses for Twitter. Products you were talking about, events. What are the more creative ways?
One of the things that that people have done really well is around sporting events and also product launches. And I just want to point out, particularly for example, in like car industry and movies, they spend tremendous amount of money on TV to launch that event. But what's really important is how many people turn up on that, particularly for a movie, the first weekend, like first launch. When some of the movie companies have used the trend to dominate the conversation the previous week, we have actually followed and found out that traffic can increase by as much as 20 to 40% in terms of excitement and buzz and actual visits to the box office the first weekend. Now, anyone in the movie industry knows that if you can increase the first weekend traffic by 20 to 40%, that's a magnitude of difference in terms of your business. So in terms of R&I, that's a huge R&I. I mean, I don't even want to get into the number of digits that sort of revealed. But also in terms of like car launches, we have found that the way people can generate conversations around an exciting car that's coming out, amplifying their return on investment, not on the Twitter ads per se, but on their total spend in terms of the TV ad that they're running, the events that they're running. There was a consolidated ROI calculation around what Twitter was contributing to the conversation around all the other events that were happening. So those were some of the most striking numbers that I saw. And these are examples that show that when you measure ROI, what tends to happen is social media gets a small cut of your ad spend, and people just try to track that through digital advertising metrics. And when in fact, there is a bigger spend that's all about creating a conversation around what you're doing or events that you're running. And when you consolidate it, Twitter tends to be the amplifying conversation tool that actually magnifies what you're trying to do with all your spend. And we're finding that creative advertisers and marketers are having a very sophisticated way of being able to capture the whole amplification of the spend.
I see a question, which is, can you tell us more about the promoted tweets and the product solutions offered by Twitter?
Yep, so we have three products. One is promoted tweet trend, which is basically at the top of your trend line, and it amplifies what's going on in that 24 hours. It's the top trend of the day. A promoted account that allows you to increase your followers. So you only pay when you get additional followers that are targeted. Thirdly, promoted tweets, which comes into your timeline. And I think I want to just mention like one thing about Twitter, which we think is very special, which is that we don't have other products. It's not a display section. It's not an ad section. Everything, all the three products are organic Twitter elements, which means that for the user, they are not experiencing something different. They're just experiencing the product Twitter that they know. And because we know what you're interested in because you're following things that you're interested in. The way we target, we believe, is probably the most direct way. A lot of companies try to estimate because I'm a male in 40s living in Tokyo that I like certain kind of cars. Now, that's a pretty complex algorithm to figure out what kind of cars I like. Whereas if I am following like a Porsche account, if I'm following a Toyota account, if I'm following a whole bunch of basketball players, you don't need an incredible science to figure out that I like those cars and that I like basketball. And so we can make the experience for the user a lot less friction in the sense of knowing what I like and being able to target and connect them to advertisers who are directly doing that, which is the reason we think we have that high engagement rate. But those three products available for targeting all around the world, in Asia, anywhere. So if anyone's interested, we have them available, and we're excited to
develop them. And this concentration on monetization, you're not a listed company at this point, so you wouldn't be facing questions about your share price that other companies might.
Right. I mean, we're still a private company.
Any plans to go public?
We have no plans to go public to announce at this point. And we are really excited about building our business first. That's what we're focused on. This is the top region in the world where we need to grow exciting uses of our product. And we believe that our promoted products, which are very, very different from regular ads, very frictionless part of the product, is the kind of stuff that creative marketers in Asia can deploy and have the most creative uses for.
I just got a tweet question from Miss XQ, whoever that is. Asking about the competitive set. Who do you view as your competitors? Is WeChat a competitor, or Weixin or some of the Sina Weibo?
Well, I think globally, we don't think we're directly competing. We're in a broader social platform space, but Twitter, we believe, offers a very, very unique real-time product, which amplifies a broader conversation on internet. And that's a very specific use, which is quite different from just connecting, you know, your friends or sort of professional linkage platform, for which you know, Facebook or LinkedIn may frankly be better platforms. So we are really about what's happening right now, real time, that conversation. And for that use globally, I don't think, you know, we're obviously respectful and we're watching everyone who's doing innovative things, but we want to focus on what we're good at. And for what we're good at, which is real time information platform, I don't think there is a global competitor right now.
Speaking of real time information for, you spoke about events, the Olympics or an event like that, are there brands that have used that in a powerful way? Are there any that you would highlight? Maybe even Asian.
Yeah, there have been a tremendous amount of brands that have used it. I'll just mention Coca-Cola. Coke has a whole range. I mean, they're obviously a big Olympic player, but they had a set of creative hashtags around players that everyone wanted to root for. And the amount of rooting hashtag tweets that were happening, which were linked to replies from that player, and basically a conversation that was happening on their webpage, was astounding, because, you know, particularly in Asia, and when you think about, for example, like Korean excitement around some of their Olympics players, or, you know, this is probably everywhere else, we saw probably, I'd like to say, about 10,000-fold increase in the number of conversation about a specific player who's linked to a specific product. And then I don't know how to track the result of that, but during maybe 4 or 5 matches that a particular swimmer was playing in, the conversation on Twitter around those days may have been about 20% around that specific swimmer in Japan. So an incredible amount of conversation that's not really the ads. You know, it's really the ability to shape a very, very creative hashtag, which is the center of conversation that's happening not only on internet, but around a specific country, that a powerful brand like Coke was able to generate.
So they end up hosting a conversation and curating something.
Yeah, and the hashtag that they were using in Japan with the Japanese swimmer case was "I can do it." And this was a guy who had won Olympics twice before.
Sorry, the hashtag for the swimmer was "I can do it."
Yeah, "I can do it." So he tweeted out as he got onto the national team, you know, "I can do it." And it was his third run. He had run like, he'd gotten like gold medal twice. People thought he was too old to be qualified. He got qualified, and he was like, you know, I can do it. And he was like, I can get to the final. I can get to the next stage. But people, he was also calling out to everyone saying, you know, what's your resolution? What can you do this year? And so everyone, you know, all the public was tweeting in, you know, I can do this year. You know, I want to challenge this. And so it became a national conversation about what can we do this year to go beyond our boundaries. And so that was a really, really creative conversation, which is centered around the Olympics and an individual, but it's really about us and what's our resolution this year and what can we do. And the brand had a great resonance with "I can do it" message. And so I thought that was a really, really smart way of creating a movement around the Olympics, but around a bigger conversation.
Excellent. Finally, the issue of celebrity. We spoke about that earlier. We're going to have a celebrity. We're having a live performance here by the artists who launched iTunes in Asia for Apple. Mm-hmm. What is the relationship? How do you see that working? And is it different in Asia from where it is elsewhere? Or any not just limited to celebrity, are there any differences between Twitter and Asia that you would highlight versus Twitter elsewhere?
I don't think there's a huge difference, but I'd like to say that Twitter is one of the most active platforms that celebrities engage in. And what we tend to find is that they use Twitter because they can talk about the backstage, and their fans want to see the backstage. And so a lot of celebrities have reached out to us, and we're verifying like thousands of them across the region about, you know, what is it that excites their fans. And frankly, on major TV networks or magazines, they can't show that personal side. They can't show the backstage. They can't show that they're nibbling on their favorite sweet backstage before they jump on. And it's these things and the conversations they can directly have with their fans that really excites
their fan base. And I think what's interesting now is that I'm seeing that when sponsors, companies, are now actually looking at the number of followers that the celebrity has before signing them on for an ad, because they know that in addition to that person appearing on an ad, that person can talk about how the commercial was taken or when it's coming on air and the event that the person is coming to. The celebrity is really the mobilization like machine. They literally have an audience base and an asset base that's independent of the media. And I think we're going to see a lot more of that. And this is really about empowering the celebrity, him or herself, and really giving that special connection to the fans.
Sometimes empowering them to undermine themselves when they tweet about products launches like that are not the product they're launching.
Right, but you know, I'd also like to mention that when people say there has been like mistakes like that, some of those mistakes are not really mistakes.
They were really paid by Apple and not Samsung at that launch.
Right. It tends to generate a lot more conversation around that person.
The controversy
sometimes pays. And so, you know, I think, you know, people, even when the mistakes are getting made, when we review them, in many cases, it shows that that person's a human being. And often there are many, many ways that that person can come back in. So I think, you know, celebrities, Asia, very big, particularly, you know, we're looking at Korean K-pop stars, huge fan base all across Asia, and also now reaching the US, and we're working with them to try to figure out how they can capture basically a broader conversation, multilingual, multi-country, but very, very creative uses.
K-pop taking over the
K-pop,
world.
K-pop, yep.
Okay, thank you very much,
Great,
James.
Thank you so much,
us.
Everyone.
Thank you.